Здравствуйте, люди добрые. Меня зовут Сева Каплан. Сейчас вас ожидает некоторый сюрприз. Я изготовился сделать интервью с Дагласом Сенчури, который написал книгу под названием «Последний босс Брайтона». Герой этой книги – Борис Найфилд, кличка Биба. Самый известный уж в англоязычном мире, это точно. Профессиональный преступник, который стал таковым, ну как вот некоторые становятся политиками, некоторые по наследству, так сказать, папа был дантист, и сын тоже получается дантист, а Биба стал преступником. И об этом книга Дагласа Сенчури. Но Даг не говорит по-русски, поэтому сейчас перейдем на английский. И те из вас, кто хотел бы не пропустить ни слова, вы можете посмотреть в записи это интервью на моем канале Сева Каплан на YouTube, включив в settings subtitles. Там на 60 языков можно перевести. Okay, Doug, thank you very much for sharing a part of your life with modest me on this particular day, which coincidentally signifies the first 100 anniversary of the Wimbledon tennis
Oh,
tournament.
okay.
Yeah, and your last name is Century. Is it your real name or it's your writer's nickname?
No. My family were Jewish from three of my grandparents from Bialystok, but my grandfather Louis Century came from Warsaw, and the name we have gravestones going back. I think our first ancestor, at least the late 1700s, early 1800s. Simca Century, and it was pronounced in Polish Centuria, but all I have a branch of my family in London and many in Chicago. There's a lot of centuries, so it's not made up, it's the real Jewish name, and it's an unusual Jewish name.
But if I remembered correctly, Centurion was a Roman regiment of some kind, right?
Yes, well, we had many theories. One of my dad's uncle Chaim, who was in Chicago, wrote to a Jewish genealogical expert, and he thought it might be what the Jewish people used to use, the gentian violet. It was a medicinal herb that was called the century plant, and he said it's most likely that your ancestor Simca Century was a dealer of herbs. But then we had a big family reunion about 4 years ago in Chicago, and apparently that's mythology. I think for most Russians had the same experience when Napoleon came through. So my name in Hebrew would be David Ben Yaakov. I don't think many Jews had last names, and when Napoleon came through, it started the process of people accepting many. Like if you were a blacksmith, you might be Schmid, right? But we don't know where it came from, but there's many headstones in Warsaw that say Century, and many, unfortunately, many ancestors of mine, my parents, uncles, aunts, what cousins went to Treblinka. When Warsaw got, they were really in Mila 18, the famous street where, the uprising, and none survived the war. But they're Polish on that side. My other side, I call Russian, even though Bialystok was disputed territory between the Russian Empire and Poland. It was always being pulled back and forth.
The name of this town, Bialystok, was famed by the Mel Brooks production in the producer's movie, right? The main characters are
Oh,
coming
yeah.
from Bialystok. Probably as a man who writes words for a living, you understand that most of us reflect in our live activities the contents of our last name. For instance, Boris Neifeld, if translated into simplified English, would mean the guy who belongs to the field where everybody says no, nein. It's like, right?
Nine. Yeah,
He's
nine. You get it.
in
Yeah. Yeah.
denial by definition, by default.
Wow.
Don't you think
Wow.
so? There is a coincidence of a kind.
Yeah. Well, I think our names, I always thought my name was a, I'll tell you, like, so my name is Douglas. My real name in Hebrew is David, but my dad's name was Jack. And when I was in graduate school, studying writing, a woman said, "Your name is really Century." I said, "Yeah, my mother is Marsha Century. My father was Jack Century." And she said, "Could I use that as a character in a play I'm writing?" And I said, "Dad, a girl wants to use your name, Jack Century. It sounds so powerful." But I thought it might be new field, but you're right. Nine. I studied Yiddish as a kid. Nine is or nein in Yiddish. No. Yeah. No. A person in the field saying no.
You know,
That's fascinating.
Yeah, what is interesting, especially to me in terms of play on words, is that Biba, in his younger years, was the only Jewish guy in Gomel, as you know, who decided to openly wear the Star of David on his chest. And your original Jewish name is David, and you, David Century, just made a star out of Biba.
Wow, you see, you've got an
So
very,
he
very,
paid his dues a long time ago.
Well, that's a very interesting thing that people see in the book, and there's a photo that backs it up. At first, he Biba's obviously, let's be honest, it's like many guys who were criminals, and they love the self-mythology and the self-aggrandizement, I guess you'd call it. But he said, I was the first guy in my city. And my translator, I worked with a very experienced translator, he said, no, Doug, he's right, you couldn't buy a Star of David in the Soviet Union. So he went to a jeweler and had to make one. And he said, and I wore it outside my turtleneck so everybody could see. So there's a photo in the book that you could show if you'd like of him at the Gomel City Hall with his crew. And it's somebody else's wedding, but somehow Biba is the front guy in the picture. And there you see it. And I guess it took some chutzpah, right? In the Soviet era, you would know more than me, to actually say, I'm going to wear a Star of David.
Yeah, it took guts to wear the Star of David in the Soviet Union, definitely.
And I think that was one thing I found admirable. Obviously, we're going to talk about there's many things that are not admirable, or that Biba's one of the most self-effacing people I know in terms of him saying, "Doug, I'm not a good guy. I'm not a good. I was not a good husband. I am not a good person." He says that all the time. I am a bad person. So he has no illusions about what he's done with his life. But there were moments in the book, I think you can say this better than me, when you that horrible slur that means like you have a kike's mug, Židovskaya Mordo. Am I saying it correctly?
Exactly, yeah.
He said, if I
Židovskaya
heard, yeah, if I heard that, I said, somebody would say that to you? No, if they said it to one of my friends, I would beat him straight away. Well, I'll talk to you a little bit later about Benya Crick and Isaac Babel. I found that kind of admirable. You're going to stand up for your friends. You're not going to take anti-Semitic abuse.
Oh,
I'm
people in the criminal world, and I know some Jewish guys who spent a lot of their lifetime in prison. They are really proud when they get a nickname which begins with Jid. For instance, my best friend who applied for a visa the same year as when I did, my family did. I ended up in the United States, and he ended up in prison, and he got a nickname of Jid Moskovsky. So he was very proud of it. And there's no anti-Semitism at all in the Russian Gulag system. People are, valued according to their human values, so to speak, not according to their nationality, which we don't choose. But what you just said of Biba, it's two different standards. On the street, nobody dares to call him Jid, but in prison, it's a word of honor. By the way, you mentioned that.
I just wanted to say one thing. I was rereading. I studied this in Isaac Babel's famous Odessa stories, and of course people know of Benya Crick, but there is a character they call Yid and a Half. I don't know what it is. It must be Jid probably, but yeah, one of the gangster characters is called Yid and a, like he's so strong, he's a Jew and a half, and the translator uses Yid, which must be.
Well, I know a very famous guy. He's a director of the Moscow Operetta Theater. His last name is Tartakovsky, and his nickname in his childhood years was exactly that, Poltara Zhida. A Yid and a half means that he's
There you
not
go.
just a weed, he's 50% more than a
Yes,
Yid.
exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Actually, Biba is a 50% Jewish guy because his mother was a Ukrainian, and according to the Jewish law, he's not Jewish at all. But in the Soviet Union, it was the other way around. If your father, whatever your father is, they considered you belong to the same nationality. But
Well,
anyway.
as you, I was going to say, yeah, you know. Many times I learned this in the translation. A very respectful way to refer. Boris's father's name was Mikhail, and Mikhail Neufeld was in the Gulag when Boris was born, actually, out in Sakhalin Island. But you would call him Mikhailich, so I can understand that who your father is, at least in the patronymic way of address in the Russian language, is very crucial. And also people have to know this if they don't know Biba's story. The woman he called mom his whole life was a Riva, his grandmother, his Baba. And he said, this woman was more my mother than my birth mother. So, technically by the Jewish law, if your mother's not Jewish, you're not Jewish. But if you're raised in a Jewish home and you feel like your actual grandmother who raised you and made you all the Jewish delicacies, knedlach and everything, he always talks about his grandmother's cooking was so... And his grandmother and grandfather spoke Yiddish in the home more, their preference was for Yiddish rather than Russian. So his cultural Yiddish background was pretty high, considering the Soviet Union didn't allow the open practice of Judaism, right? Sorry, I interrupted your question.
No. I love your interruptions, Doug. at the beginning, you mentioned that Biba is a dangerous guy. He speaks of himself as not a good one. But as you certainly know, he can be really charming. And this mixture of menace and charm, it's so deceptive. When I started reading your book, which is actually based on real facts, there is no fantasy in it. And I don't want you to disclose in our short interview the contents of the book. People who are in the know, they will follow our conversation. Those who don't, they just have to buy the book. But... I was a little bit concerned about over glorification on your behalf of the main character because of your family histories. You have a lot in common. Your predecessors came to America, so you could see your grandfather and your grandmother is just human beings who came to America under the same conditions like Biba did at the time. But like two generations later. So the tendency to humanize a criminal could not do well for the book, which I was a fan of. And then all of a sudden, I discover your discoveries about this particular character who you know is dangerous. And my question to you, were you scared to disclose your, real appreciation who the guy is?
Well, no, I think when I talked to you, you said when you had begun reading the book, Doug, I one thing I would tell you as a writer is you don't, it's almost like you don't hide your interest and almost affection for this man. Well, I think I have a complex view of him. He's multifaceted. He is not one thing. When he flatters me, it's very funny. I was at his house his brother's house in Staten Island. And as you guys do, as Russians do with the vodka, he made a toast. And he said something like, Doug, for me, you are even a better writer than Dostoevsky. And I looked at him and I said, Boris, you can't read English. So you haven't read anything. You haven't read anything I've written. So it was flattery, but in a way that was so obvious, I don't compare myself to Dostoevsky, but he has that sort of charm. Was I worried? I think at the end of the book, as you say, don't disclose the contents, but at the end of the book, there's a tragedy to him. And I'm conflicted about what to think. Obviously, he's done many bad deeds. For most of those bad deeds, he went to prison. There's many he didn't go to prison for. Is he a good human being? I don't like to think of the world in that duality of good and evil. He's a very interesting person. As you know, because you have your own personal history that it's not even in the book about he was going to do harm to you. And now you even are at the point where you can say, but he's an interesting man. He's a friend. I don't pretend objectivity. So I don't know if your listeners will know Hunter Thompson. Some of these guys in the new journalism of back in the 60s and 70s, they would embed themselves in a world. Hunter Thompson went with the Hell's Angels and riding his motorcycle. Later, they beat him up badly. But it's almost like the immersion into a culture in which you then pull back and I don't make a judgment on him. I leave the reader, I hope, to make their own judgment. But on balance, he has said many times to me, I am not a good person. I have not been a good father. I have not been, I was never a good, faithful husband. And so I quote him saying those things. So to me, if a person has no artifice and says who they are, let them say it. I won't disagree. I don't think he was a good husband, probably. He was probably not a good, faithful husband. And was he a good law-abiding person? No, never. He always broke the law.
But speaking of the genre your book was written in, I wouldn't call it a documentary. And also, it's not fiction. How would you name it?
Well, it's nonfiction in the style. I have a few books that I... you know, this is the fate. This is so well worn. This became the movie Goodfellas. But the original guy that was Nick Pileggi, the original guy I modeled my book on the very famous Joe Valachi, right? He was the first Genovese family soldier to talk to Peter Maas, who's deceased now. It's nonfiction in which I would say 70% of the book is told in the voice of the character. So it's definitely nonfiction. But there are points in the book where Biba will say something. Boris will say, this happened. And I will say, well, as the author, I might weigh in and say, of course, it's entirely possible that this is not the truth. And I will give I will quote the police documents that say something else. So it's a mixture of reporting, but also allowing a complex anti-hero. I don't know if that word exists in Russian, a complex anti-hero to largely tell his own story without a filter. And if I choose to weigh in, it's because I really think he probably is not telling the whole story here. He's whitewashing something. So, but it would be categorized in America as true crime and nonfiction, and maybe even memoir or something like that, right? Biography, sorry.
Mm-hmm. As you probably know, Doug, not as a writer, but as a reader of like the best journalism, that most of all, the people who come up with an idea to write an article and do some research, they are led by their original idea, and they don't like to be distracted by the reality. So they try eventually to adjust the reality to their original idea, and it turns into a fiction. And nobody knows, because this particular author could be an established man in his industry. So in times when there is no pure information at all, and we are victims of misinformation, disinformation, whatever we like, we are led to believe and like what is dictated to us by the artificial intelligence, so to speak, because as an author, you did your research, and the artificial intelligence offered you those sources who would be liked by you, because your tool of research wants you to like it. You understand? Mm-hmm. It's a mutual mm-hmm. kind of relationship. So it's a trap in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Did you try to look in the mirror like while writing the book in this
respect? That's a very good question. One thing I have to say is very important thing that happened to me. At first, I was trying to speak to Boris in English and with his family translating. So I would get certain stories wrong. And luckily, I then said, I need to record Boris in Russian and have it properly translated. So the transcripts that you read from him are really from Russian. And there were times he would have told me a story that I thought he did. Like there's a very famous scam that his boss, Yves Seagron in Leningrad, they would call it Razgon. You know the story of dressing up in police uniforms, and people in the black market would be swindled. Mm-hmm. So I thought Boris had done it. And then he said, no, in Gomel, no. In my city, we didn't have that level. That was Yves Se in Leningrad. So anyway, I tried to document, I tried to verify. When you say look in the mirror, do you mean did I try to look at my own preconceptions? And analyze them as I was writing? Is that your
mm-hmm.
question?
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, I think there were many points in which I said, am I being too kind to him? Am I being too close to him? There was a crisis I had at one point. It was the middle of the height of the pandemic where we couldn't even go anywhere. Like you couldn't even go to a coffee shop, remember? And I was talking to my daughter and my mother and I said, how on earth am I going to make anybody care or sympathize, not sympathize, but at least want to read about this man. And then I realized at a certain point, it wasn't my job to make him sympathetic. It was just to make him interesting. You know what I mean? Like all these gangster books, Henry Hill, that was the Goodfellas, Sammy the Bull. If you really scratch below the surface, their behavior is abhorrent. You know, murders and swindles and constant crime. But we have a fascination with it. We all have a fascination with the dark side of humanity. So I stopped worrying about whether I was making him sympathetic. And I just said, let me make him interesting. I don't know. My bias, at one level, my main question was, are criminals born or made? And clearly they're made. But, you know, he had choices. He had many, many choices in his life. He always said to me, had I come to America with my plan, my black market money I got out in the Soviet times, I might have bought a taxi cab and I might have lived but I don't believe that. I think he came to America and he was dead set on stealing, famous story, I won't give away too much, stealing from the supermarkets when they were in Albany. Like, it's so easy. A lot of these guys would say, it's so easy to steal in America. It wasn't that easy. Yeah. So when he says to me, had I had a different life, had I had different opportunities, maybe, and I don't believe that. I think by the time he was 18 or so, he was already 16, 17, he was a hooligan, right? The hooligan culture, he was already a criminal. And when he was being honest with me, I said, did you ever think of not being a criminal? He said, no, I was a criminal at such a young age, I can't change. That was his honest appraisal, so.
Let's talk a little bit about the most popular trend in the show business, whatever it is, television, movies, books, it's glorification of sociopathy. Every criminal is a sociopath, can be considered, because they are like, they belong to a world which is not normal, which is normal to them. But as far as the television, we got The Sopranos, which is like 20 years. The first episode came up like in the late 90s. I can't recall exactly. But the main character,
99, yeah.
Yeah, the main character played by Gandolfini is an extreme sociopath. But when you start watching it and you get hooked with the plot, you want to know what it will eventually end up with, you start liking this guy, but he's the ugliest person out of all the characters. Then we go to Dexter. Then we go to Breaking Bad. Then finally we end up with House of Cards, which is not finished because Kevin Spacey is a bad guy in real life. So this movie industry actually creates platform for real-time sociopath to become conquerors of the world. We have two examples. Vladimir Putin, he's a sociopath, and Donald Trump, in a way, he created a very sick situation in our country where we split into two approximately equal parts, hating each other. And we are still calling ourselves the United States of America. Fuck you. Come on. What is united here? So don't you find this popular tool, it's a tool to create a human being out of a criminal, out of a sociopath. Don't you think this tool reflects somehow suicidal tendencies of our country, swinging from left to right on the only boat we have for ourselves, which they used to call the Mayflower?
That's a brilliant question, because when I look back on James Gandolfini, who died tragically young, you know, he embodied and inhabited that role. I don't know how well it was translated into Russian, but, you know, if you ever heard James Gandolfini speak, he didn't have that accent, and he had to practice, and he sounded like the gangster. But as you say, you know, many people have already seen it. Yeah, he murders his own nephew. You know, he does things that you just look back and go, how do I still like him? How do I still root for him in the end? I think I mentioned to you, so it was a very, very seminal, important essay. I studied film as well as writing by a critic named Robert Warshaw in 1948, and it was called The Gangster as Tragic Hero. So 1948, he was talking about the old gangster movies, which were Jimmy Cagney and Edward G. Robinson, who was really a Jewish, short Jewish guy, but these Humphrey Bogart playing gangsters. So you have to remember, I think Russians may not know this, but the original mythology of America was sort of the cowboy outlaw. And then, so Robert Warshaw said, well, by the 40s, more people were living in cities. The West was already conquered. So now the gangster was the outlaw. And these guys have always been celebrated in songs, John Dillinger and, you know, Al Capone. These names are kind of worshipped. And yes, they're very ugly people. But in that essay, I was telling you, this is a little bit abstruse. He said, in the deeper layers of modern consciousness, all means are unlawful. Every attempt to succeed is an act of aggression, leaving one alone and guilty and defenseless among enemies. One is punished for success. So Robert Warshaw is basically saying the gangster represents all of us, or represents a kind of dark trend in American society. Getting to what you just said about Putin and Trump, yeah, I mean, you might have a problem saying this in Russia, but it's pretty obvious that Putin is the most powerful gangster, or the most powerful organized crime related figure alive. And Donald Trump's behavior in many ways is that of a mob boss. I won't call him, you know, we'll see what happens with the hearings January 6th, but he does all kinds of things that a mob boss would do. Like they would say he never put things in writing. You know, he always had, he tried never to say things that were incriminating, you know, and people who know Trump, he grew up in the construction business. It was impossible in the 1980s not to deal with Italian-American Cosa Nostra figures if you're dealing with concrete, any kind of construction. Doesn't mean that he was a gangster himself, but yeah, I think America is a gangster-driven nation in a lot of ways, and Russia seems to be led by a powerful gangster-like figure. So I think you're right, and that maybe we have adopted the entire sociopathy of the Hollywood mythology. But I think the celebration of the outlaw, I mean, talking to you again about this, is one of my formative read, you know, Isaac Babel, who I hope is still read in Russian. When I met Boris, he said to me, of course I know Babel, we all had to read the Red Horseman, but we call that Red Cavalry. But his Benya Crick stories, I mean, Benya is a gangster, and he's a killer. He defends the old Jews of Odessa, but he has a terrible end. And I don't think it's actually in the Odessa stories. I think it was only in the film that he dies in a hail of bullets. But even in Russia, you have the mythology, which was based on Mishka Yaponchik, right, the real guy, mm-hmm. who was killed by firing squad in the Civil War. So, my point is, I think that we idolize these people. In real life, no, they're not very charming, or the charm is artificial. The ugliness of that world, it's extremely destructive. It's extremely destructive to all of us. And it's troubling. I have no way of answering your question about where is America going. It's not united. It's what I observe as a journalist is that not only are there two separate camps, because the silos of information now, you can choose where you get your news. You can choose where you get Fox News versus MSNBC, or, you know, Russian language radio like yourself, which tells the truth, versus state-sponsored media, where you probably are hearing only one side of what happens in Ukraine. So because we can choose, in my childhood, Walter Cronkite, I don't know if he was famous, but he was like the most trusted man in America. He's the first journalist who said the Vietnam War was not really what was. And my dad, every night, and most Americans listened to Walter Cronkite, and you trust that was the news. Now you can choose, and you can choose which news you want to believe. Yeah, one of the most brilliant.
You can choose an influencer for yourself.
Yeah. And one of the things that Trump said that was just brilliant in a dark way to me, but, you know, he said fake news. This is almost like Stalin. Stalin did the same
yeah.
thing. Like, you know,
short and
you
precise. He created the label.
Yeah.
Understandable.
So in your childhood, I mean, you know, there's famous pictures where they didn't have Photoshop. So how did they do it? They took Trotsky out of the pictures. You know, famous pictures with Lenin, Stalin, Trotsky. Well, no, he was erased from history, like literally painted out of the picture, right? Well, you could choose how you present the news. And now we're really, as reporters and yourself, it's really on us. I think the Fifth Estate, the idea that the media has an obligation do the best it can to say what's really going on. Anyway, that's...
Yeah, well, actually, there was some underlying question which I did not pronounce while talking to you, Doug, but I'll give you an example. For instance, when I like something, like a piece of news, or I dislike a human being who is a world leader, I don't like myself. I try to fact check my attitude in many mm-hmm. different ways. And for instance, I really like the book by Mary Trump, the niece of Donald Trump. But after having read that book, I came to a conclusion that Trump is a victim of circumstances. He is a victim of his upbringing by Freddie Trump. And Trump just managed, Donald Trump managed to survive under very unhuman conditions, which is obvious in the Mary Trump's book, but probably was not her ultimate goal. She hated her uncle, and she had her reasons. So I think that if, for instance, the Hollywood come up with a show about Donald Trump life, his picture would be accepted in a very different light by most of those who hate him now. And on the other side, the Ukrainian president, Vladimir Zelensky, had he not been a main character in one of the very popular shows in Ukraine called Sluga Naroda, the servant of the people, he would have never become a president, because we pray to our screens, and it's inevitable. So on the one hand, the internet gives you a variety of sources to trust or mistrust. On the other hand, we don't have those black and white world which would tell us this is true and that is false. So let's leave it to mathematicians, right? To the
math. That's logic. A very good point. That's a very good point you make, because, you know, I have my own biases. We all do. But you're right. Like Trump, I was never a fan, and I am not. But you're right. His father was sort of monomaniacal in shaping him, that you cannot lose, you cannot fail, any kind of weakness, you know. But this is true of it's true of Boris Neufeld. It's true of every criminal you look at. If you really take their life experiences into account, you go back to childhood. But then we say to ourselves, are we just making apologies now for bad behavior? We all do have choices, even with the circumstances. We say in English, the cards being stacked against you, right? You have a bad hand, you're dealt a bad hand. You still have choices about whether you're going to be a decent human being or not. So, but it's a very good point you make, that we have to fact check our own, really make sure we understand why we think the way we do. You know, what Trump said too at one point, just off the cuff, he said, what you're seeing and what you're hearing is not what's happening. Remember that? And I said, that was brilliant, because then you're saying, wow, can I even trust the live feed from C-SPAN? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, actually, because of Trump, the expression alternate reality became so popular on both sides of the aisle.
For guys like you who were born in the Soviet Union, you knew this full well. You knew you were getting an official version from the state. But everybody still knew that, oh, well, things were probably much different. Maybe you didn't know all the specifics of what was really happening in the United States, England, Canada. But once the Beatles records, you were a musician, once the Beatles records and things reached the people, you started to realize what they're telling us and what we can't trust the official version, you know. So you all grew up with that, right, in the Soviet times, for sure.
Yeah. You know, I'll disclose you the way I see myself now, after the second part of my life is going on in the United States. In the first part, when I was a Soviet citizen, a citizen of a country which does not exist anymore, I thought that the system was extremely wrong and I needed to either get rid of it, which was impossible, it was not in my power, or leave it the way it was. And after living in the United States for the last 34 years, I came to a conclusion that I really was the enemy of that people, because that people I was a part of did not need enemies like myself. So I'm on the other side of the mirror. My last question to you, Doug, would be, because you met many Russians, American people belonging to our diaspora here. What is your personal impression? Don't you think that some of us are a so-called stable of Trojan horses for Putin in America?
That's a wonderful expression. It was just stable. I mean, I grew up in Canada, and we had the first Jewish emigres coming in the 70s. And so I've known Russian speaking. I don't like that word Russian because many came from Ukraine. And, well, for example, at the Jewish Community Center where we'd go, these guys had a different standard of, they were rude and aggressive. So we all got used to how you couldn't play soccer with the Russians because it would just be, it would be a different level, to be arguments. And then when you factor in some Israelis, it became, and then I also realized too, I can always tell a Russian face because they don't smile at you. Until they know you very well, there's a very, it's a different culture. And I'm gonna be a full disclosure. So I consider, except for one grandfather, Polish. My other three grandparents were Russian, and they all left before the revolution, and they all were true believers in the left, in the communist system. Of course, so I actually came to this book thinking, let me understand how bad was it in the Soviet times. And reading Boris's explanation of everything he went through, and also with my translator explaining, Doug, you have to understand what it was like to get one bath a week, this was the socialist paradise, the workers' paradise. I came away from this book, one of the things I learned is how wrong it was to believe in that, at least the Stalinist state. There was no good to that. I mean, you can't defend it. There's no defense to the murders. But currently, I have found, at least from Boris and some of the others, there's Russian Jews here in Canada. Yes, they follow. They do think that the invasion of Ukraine was right. They are defending Putin's position on it, and it surprises me. Boris said to me when I was driving, we were driving to meet you for coffee. He said, come on, Doug, this is bullshit country. This is anti-Semite country. Why do you guys even care about this country? And I said, come on. I mean, you don't accept that there's a humanitarian crisis going on? So, but I don't know if that's because you're Trojan horses for Putin, or my question to you, is that because the sources of information that are coming in Russian, I mean, your show exception to that, right, are the official line? Is that the reason most of the people I know who are from the former Soviet times are pro-Putin and pro this war, which I find hard to believe. But
directly speaking, most of the older generation of our diaspora are not pro-Putin, but they were definitely pro-Trump. And since Trump was pro-Putin, and it showed indirectly through Trump, they became Putin's followers. Plus, they watched the Kremlin-sponsored TV stations. And yes, a little by little, it's like when we talked about humanization and glorification of crime in the characters like Gandolfini and so on. They become a victim of this kind of informational feed without even knowing it.
Yeah, it's true. Well, I'll tell you, this is, you're probably running out of time, but I had to lead I can still read a little Hebrew, and I had to lead a Passover Seder for my mother's retirement community. And there's one little guy, he's such a sweet guy, I won't give his name, but he was born in the Soviet times. He must be in his 80s now. And my mother said, she asked him, what do you feel about what's going on in the war? And he said, the Russians killed us, the Ukrainians killed us, now they're killing each other. Like, he was just shrugging, almost like, as Jews, we survived it all. So, I mean, I hear differing points of view. My impression of the Russian Jewish community, or Russian speaking expatriate, is actually, I have a very positive view now because it's so highly educated, so highly valued. People like your father, who was a famous concert pianist, yeah. There was a value for culture, a value put on education. So I find that admirable. I find them rude as well. A lot of people are very pushy and rude, but that's just cultural. Israelis are the same way. It's a high stress environment you guys came from. So I think it creates a kind of toughness And at least among the Jews that I know who came from those eras, there's a lot to admire. I think there's a lot to admire. A lot I would disagree with politically, but also a lot to admire.
Thank you very much, Douglas Century. Doug, all the best of my respect and good luck with your book.
Seva, thank you for having me on, and maybe we'll do book two that explains some of your own personal history with Boris.
I wouldn't mind with you.
When that whole story needs to be told in another format, okay?
All right.
So
thank you, Doug.
Thank you for having me on.
Sure.